previously on Ad Passion and Stir.
We're in Washington, D.C. today. My sister, Debbie Shore, is with me, and we've got two really special guests. Jim Wallis, who is the founder, president, CEO of Sojourners, both the organization and Sojourners magazine, and such an important voice in our country on a range of issues from inequality to racial justice to faith. He's the author of, I think, at least a dozen books, but I think the most recent is America's Original Sin, Racism, White Privilege, and the Bridge to a New America. And our good friend Michael Schlow, who has been a champion for Share Our Strength. He's a James Beard Award winner for the Northeast. He's got restaurants in Boston, L.A., and D.C. Here in D.C., it's the Rigsby, Tico, and Alta Strada. You've just, you know, you've been an amazing friend to us for a long time, Michael, and we're thrilled to have you on. There was something that felt wrong to you, mm-hmm. and I think I know what you mean in terms of probably the inequality and so forth, but say a little bit more about, for you personally, what did you actually see, and what was it specifically that touched your heart?
Well, it was about... It was about this last book I wrote, America's Original Sin. It was about racism. So I become friends with Butch. We're janitors together, Detroit Edison. Big, strong guys, like moving the heaviest desks around. He's black and I'm white. We become buddies. I'm old enough to remember when we had elevator operators.
Right.
So when those little guys were sick, they put me and Butch in the elevators. They got to give you breaks when you're doing the elevator. So I go into his elevator on my break and ride up and down with him and talk, and he comes into mine, and we talk and talk, takes me home for dinner. And his mother says to me, well, so I tell my kids, we're talking about police in Detroit. So I tell my kids, if you're ever lost, can't find your way home, and you see a policeman, duck under a stairwell, hide behind a building, wait till he's gone, come out and find your way home. And when Butch's mother said that to me, she's just like my mother, not political, militant, cared about her kids, worried about her son's radical ideas. My mom said to her five kids, if you ever lost, can't find your way home, look for a policeman. A policeman is your friend, and he'll take you by the hand and bring you home. So those moments, those epiphanies, we might say, are what changed my life. I remember Butch's mom saying that as clearly right now talking to you is when I heard her say that. So that changes your whole worldview.
How old were you when this happened?
Oh, maybe 16.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, just as you were arriving, we were talking with Michael about an early experience that touched your heart, and it was as personal as could be in terms of growing up in a family that was pretty well off, and then your dad left and your circumstances changed. And as somebody who's been an advocate for our work on school nutrition assistance and the SNAP food stamp program and school meals, these are programs that actually you connect with personally.
I had a personal experience in that. As I said, when we were getting together this morning, was that my family needed to use welfare, and back then it wasn't called SNAP, but we had, I'm dating myself here, like you are, Jim, about the operators of the elevator. I had a little coin that the government gave me to get my very special lunch, and I was saying to Billy that I struggle with the term, food insecurity. I don't think it's a strong enough term, and I know we don't use it at Share Our Strength, but it is something you hear often or you see it, written. And it's just not a strong enough term. I was hungry. I wasn't insecure. I was hungry. And the notion of, like, whether it's breakfast after the bell or, for some kids like myself, my mom had gone to work. She got off of welfare and she got a job. But there were moments in my young childhood where we were very, very almost, I hate to use the word, but I felt ashamed of the fact that we couldn't afford the food. And that's a case where government helped, but we also didn't abuse the system. My mother got off of welfare. She got a job, worked her way up in an office and became the office manager. It was a great story, and I'm very proud of my mom and how she raised us and never let us really know just how poor we were. We were very wealthy as little kids, but my stepfather
back to the beginning. Your dad left when you were very young.
Yeah, my dad left when I was 9 years old, 8, 9 years old, and my mom raised us, and for a number of years, it was just the four of us, my brother, my sister, and myself and my mom. And then my mom met the gentleman who would become my stepfather, who really took over our family and became my father. And when I turned 40 years old, just as a gesture of love more than anything, it had nothing to do with, you know, inheritance or anything like that. It was just because he had been my father. At 40 years old, I asked him to adopt me. And I did it on Father's Day. Aww. So I got adopted at 40. And he was from here in D.C., and so I pay homage to him in a lot of things with the restaurants that I do.
Hi, I'm Billy Shore. Welcome back to Add Passion and Stir for the second part of our conversation with Jim Wallis from Sojourners and Michael Schlow, chef and restaurateur from Boston, Washington, D.C., and a number of other locations. We had the opportunity to air an episode last week, and the conversation was so good that we wanted to extend it. Jim, I had read where you had said that, speaking of immigration, that the wall was a monument to racism and to Trump's vanity, which I thought was pretty powerful. Say a little bit more about that.
Well, this isn't political disagreement. I mean, the wall does not protect us from terrorists. Terrorists don't come in over the southern border. The wall doesn't protect us from drugs. Drugs come in by Trump's own administration. Yeah. It comes in through ports of entry, cities. This idea of the wall will protect us from crime by immigrants is not true. Immigrants who come to this country commit far less crimes than those already living here. All the data shows that. So these are things just to make people afraid. And Jesus said, don't be afraid. Don't be so afraid. Fear is used for the resentment and for the hate and for the racism. It's fear that's being created. It's not true. What he's saying is just not true. The wall is a statement. He ran on this. This was his key issue. And what the wall says is we want to keep non-white people out of this country. Yeah. That's what the wall is all about. It's his core. It's his base. There is no effectiveness. There's no disagreement. Talk to southern border politicians. The wall is a joke, but it really is a symbol of the kind of nation that Donald Trump is trying to create. So to me, it's a monument to the kind of racism that we have fought from the beginning of our country. So to me, the wall is a symbol that just must not be accepted. So we're going to see in the next couple of days what happens here.
Yeah. Well, the other part about that, if I could chime in, you know, from a very, again, personal standpoint, we started the conversation with that I was a dishwasher. And I was a dishwasher in a restaurant that had three other kids just like me washing dishes. Do you know how many American white kids I have washing dishes in my restaurants across the country? And by the way, I have a restaurant now just outside of Detroit, which is a place that I want to invest in. I'm in Birmingham on the first one. We're testing out the waters in the suburbs first, and then we're going into Detroit. But how many white American kids
zero.
Do you think? Zero.
Yeah.
Zero. Yep. They won't do the job. Yep. They don't want the job. They want to come in and they want to be sous chef, you know, without actually knowing how to, you know, butcher a fish yet or something like that. But this country needs constant immigration. Of course it should be legal. Of course it should be done in a certain way. But let's create some reform that's realistic. You know, we need people to do this. We were talking earlier before the show about the Farm Bill. You know, we need immigrants to come into this country and to continually feed the workforce here. Because I could tell you that in our industry, in the restaurant industry, there isn't a restaurant in this country that doesn't have an opening right now. Nobody
that's right.
is fully
yeah,
staffed.
That's right.
Well, I'll just share one thing about the border that I think goes to exactly what we were talking about in terms of who people really are and the need to connect them. We were down there visiting Sister Norma Pimentel's respite center. I'm sure you know
She's
her better
amazing.
Than I do. She's an amazing woman. This is a Catholic Charities respite center. And the Border Patrol brings as many as 500 families a day to this respite center, families who they're probably not going to get asylum, but they at least have some plausible claim. Mm-hmm. So they're not being immediately sent back to Mexico and they're not being detained. Some of them have been detained. Some of them had electronic ankle monitors. But most of them are coming directly from 3 months on the road from Honduras, El Salvador, Guatemala, what have you. And this is where they get their first meal, their first hot meal, mm-hmm. A shower, help buying a bus ticket to where a sponsor might be able to put them up while their legal case follows them. And it's the Border Patrol that bring these families directly there. There's a lot of choices the Border Patrol can make, and most of these Border Patrol agents are actually very, very good men and women. They treat these families very tenderly and very, kind of compassionately. And Sister Pimentel told us the story of one of the Border Patrol agents looking in the window while the families were being fed, and he said to her, "Thank you for reminding us that we're human beings."
Mm-hmm. And the Border Patrol didn't come up with a policy to separate children from their parents.
Right.
That was Washington. And they saw what it was doing, separating kids from their parents. And Sister Norma, lots of other folks, are down there trying to reunite families. So these, you know, and back to that text, Jesus said, as you treat the stranger, which means those people, refugees, immigrants, that's how you treat me. So you got a faith conversation going on about how our faith is at stake in all this, not just our politics. Mm-hmm. So when that wall stands for something that is antithetical to the gospel I believe in, or the house that you grew up in, or my clubhouse next to the baseball field, we have to speak of those not just as political disagreements. There's no argument for a wall on effectiveness. What it means is a monument and a symbol to something that is the worst of America, worst of our history, and we have to say that's not who we are, that's not where we're going. Of course, it's got to be a sane, humane, legal system. We all need immigration reform. We all want that. But how do we do it in a way that really speaks the future we want? So when my son was fifth grade, public school in D.C., they're studying immigration. They bring in parents often to talk about something they're involved in. So I'm in there. I'm telling all these kids, most of whom I've coached in Little League, there are 11 million undocumented people in this country. They can't get health care, police protection, a broken system. Both parties are responsible for that broken system. And they're afraid of their family not being together at night for dinner because somebody might get deported. These kids, fifth graders, they look at me astonished. That's wrong. We should fix that. Congress should fix that. Have you talked to them? I said, yeah, we've talked to them. What do they say? They say they're afraid. What are they afraid of? And I looked at these kids, D.C. school, public school, fifth grader, African American, Hispanic, Asian American, Native American, Caucasian, Somali. I looked at them, I said, they're afraid of you.
Mm-hmm. Huh. Mm-hmm. Of this.
Of what you of guys diversity. Look like, what yeah. you represent. Why are they afraid of us? Because you're the future. This is what this nation's going to look like. And some people are afraid of that. They said, why? Well, they've never experienced it. They don't know it. They don't have any friends like you. How's it working? I said, well, at least it's working great. It's really cool. Well, we have to convince the nation that this is really cool.
If you take the wall and the border fight and even the Trump administration aside, I want to take advantage of your long view perspective over all of these years. Are we going in the right direction or the wrong direction? And again, I know it's hard to take the immediate out of the picture, but if you take the Trump administration and all of the vitriol and the rhetoric, if you take that out before Trump, were we headed in the right direction as a nation or the wrong direction on the kind of issues we've been discussing?
I think Donald Trump has revealed... He didn't cause all this. He's revealed what was already there. And so this presents us, and you mentioned opportunity, the symbols for the word crisis in Chinese are two symbols, danger and opportunity. Mm-hmm. We face enormous danger. Our democracy is literally at stake now. It's not clear that our institutions will have the resilience to survive all this. That is not yet clear. The soul of the nation is at stake, and also the integrity of faith. But if we realize what's at stake, and if we go deeper into whatever it is we call faith, deeper into our relationship with each other across racial lines, and deeper into relationship with those whom Jesus talked about in that 25th chapter of Matthew, who are hungry and thirsty and naked and stranger and sick and in prison, that could change us if we go deeper. There won't be a quick fix or an easy solution, or just electing somebody else. I'm all for elections, changing leadership, but it's going to be deeper than that. This could take us to a different nation because we're becoming a different nation.
But
now.
You touched on something, Jim, that I think needs to be underscored, and that is that no matter what your politics are, you're right. Trump didn't actually cause this. This was here. He just allowed the lid to be opened up and for this to come flowing out and making it Exactly. I hate to say it, but it's like everyday, mm-hmm. you know, rhetoric from him. And he's allowing this.
Mm-hmm. Made it okay.
And is making it's this hate part. Okay. Yeah. And that's the part that I just can't seem to get over. And I don't understand, you know, I always want to believe that we're decent, you know, good people at heart, that everybody is. And my wife will say to me sometimes, you know, you're an eternal optimist and maybe you need to be a little bit more of a realist. And unfortunately, hate is something that is really prevalent in our country. And now it's been exposed just how bad some of this really is. And so I go back again to the parents, and that if your parent taught you to hate, chances are it's going to be really hard to unwind that as an adult. You know, you get stuck with these things. We all are products of our environment as a child and as an adult, and we go through these experiences. And we need to do something that's as unifying as possible to get people to understand that this isn't right, you know, that mm-hmm. you don't hate somebody because their skin color is different. You don't hate somebody because they're from a different country or they have a different religion. That's not a good reason to hate somebody or to be afraid of them, as you said. And so through food, I mean, we try to do that. And we break bread. And we have, you know, when I was a kid, the communal table did not exist in a restaurant. I love communal tables. Or we did a dinner the other night at Nama, which is my new sushi restaurant in D.C. There's a shameless plug for that. And, but what we did is we only sat at the counter and everybody ate together, you know, and it was one seating. We all ate together, and I told stories. And little by little, if everybody can do some of those things, I mean, that's a start, is breaking bread together. It's a start. But there's more that obviously needs to be done.
After just 9/11, there was a television thing that attacked Muslims, and my son, Luke, was 8 years old, and he said, Dad, that's not true. That's not true what that guy just said about Muslims. Muhammad is not like that at all.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So when people who are for immigration reform are usually the people who know immigrants. Mm-hmm. The people who are most against all that, against who want the wall, are people who don't know immigrants. So how do we find the tables? How do we find the places? How do we find the venues? We finally get to know who each other are. Hear our stories. Stories are told over dinner.
Yeah.
In terms of where that table should be, we're going to end on a I guess a lighter note, because one of the things our listeners are always interested in is where is a great place to have that meal. If there's a hidden gem, and Michael, it can't be one of your own restaurants. Your restaurants
yes.
are great places to have that meal, but you're also an expert on food in Washington and Boston and a lot mm-hmm. of other places. So I was going to ask each of you, somebody's inspired and says, I'm actually going to pull together a group of people, and where's a place that might not be on the radar screen, I might not have seen reviewed, where would be a nice place to take folks and have a great meal and a conversation? Where
well,
would you
that
recommend?
Hasn't been reviewed. I mean, most
well, it doesn't,
of
the, yeah. no, it doesn't have to be
just,
that case.
Just a place just to go and have a great
a
meal.
A place that folks just may not know about.
Yeah, I mean,
or your go-to place.
Well, I have so many. You know, once I find a place that I love, I keep going back to it. Like, I'll say that 9 out of 10 meals out are a place that I've been to before, and then that 1 out of 10 is something that's new, and hopefully that becomes a new regular spot. It doesn't always work that way, but, you know, it's my hope. And so I always find myself going back to the places that food is important, but the experience is more important. It goes back to the idea of breaking bread together and sitting at a table and being able to converse. So I like to go to places, you know, and I actually put them up on my website. There's this thing called Chef Recommends. And
okay, well, give us one.
So in each place, and these are all different price points, obviously, but sure. like there's a place that I just love to go have dinner in Boston called Select Oyster, and it's a great place. It's small. We'll bring friends if they're coming from out of town. I mean, I have about 20 restaurants in Boston. I'm not trying to, you know, get any of my friends.
Is that Michael Serpa?
It is,
the chef?
Yeah.
Because he rode 300 miles with us. We do a ride called Chef Cycle, Jim, 100 miles a day for 3 days.
His food
and
is
he
delicious.
Was, he was an amazing rider.
Yeah, I like
Select
him.
Oyster. That's a good one.
It's a good one.
And give us one in D.C. too.
In D.C., let's see, I have so many new favorite spots. I just had, I had a delicious meal at Himitsu. Have you
oh,
been
yeah.
there yet?
Yeah, my sister loves
Himitsu. I just went there a couple weeks ago and just had not only a great meal, the food was delicious, but the service was spectacular. And again, there's 20 or 30 restaurants in each of these cities that I could name. And
But Chef Recommends on your website, michaelschlow.com. Michael, S-C-H-L-O-W.
Correct.
.com. Yeah. Is the place to go. I've seen that.
Yeah,
and
I do it for every city that I go to. It has Rome and Florence and, you know, all kinds. London's on there, San Francisco. And, you know, some of my friends will get mad at me and say, like, hey,
why am I not on there? And I might say, I didn't have, no, I'm teasing. Maybe I just forgot, but I got to put more stuff up there for sure.
Jim, where would we find you if we wanted to finish this conversation over a good meal?
Probably the best meal I've had in a long time was the one after that two-week fast, because anything tastes good. But we had Jose Andres' broth.
Okay.
It tasted really good. And again, the issue was who was eating it. You know, those who've been fasting, yes, immigrants, faith leaders, and those who came. And it was such a powerful notion. So I would say, I'm looking at the table, and I'm going to use a phrase, where are the uncommon tables? Mm-hmm. Where are people who really are not the same, who are not just like each other? But where are the uncommon? We're going to need some uncommon tables in this country. And I think maybe the best place are going to be people's own homes, where they decide to go to dinner someplace where they've not been before, with families that they don't normally have dinner with, or invite people to their houses and create those places. There's lots of restaurants that I know and like, but create those uncommon tables in our own homes.
And the intimacy that you can have in your own home.
I know we're running out of time, but I was going to say that brings up a point, though, where, you know, when we were kids, the idea of going over to somebody's house and, you know, the moms would get together for coffee and the kids would play, that's gone. None of my neighbors knock on my door and say, hi, how are you doing today? Like, you barely say hello to each other in the elevator. We live in Boston in a, you know, a small building, but, you know, it's a condo. And the notion of who's your friend even in your in your buildings, you barely know your neighbors today. And I think that's where it could start, is learning who your neighbors are, inviting them over for something. That would be a great way to start this. Yeah, the dinner party seems to have, I don't know why, people joke with me. They say, you know, do you ever get invited to somebody's house for dinner? I said, rarely, but the reality is you could give me a peanut butter and jelly sandwich. It's the act of hospitality and that gesture of giving.
Yes.
It is already a good meal.
I'll have you over.
Great,
okay, good.
As long as I don't have to cook it the next day.
Okay.
That's a great note to end on. Thank you so much. Really, just such a treat to have both of you. Michael Schlow, your restaurants here in D.C. are the Rigsby, Altastrada, Tico, and you mentioned, is it
Nama? Nama and Casolari, yeah. So that's what we have here in D.C. And then L.A., we have Cavatina. In Detroit, just outside of Detroit, is Adachi. And then in Boston, there's another Tico and Altastrada and Altastrada. In Connecticut, we are busy. So.
And you can find it all at michaelschlow.com.
Yes.
And Jim Wallis, such an inspiration to so many of us for so long. Your voice is just, it's always been important. I think it's never been more critical. And the work of Sojourners, Sojourners Magazine, your books, just really vital. Thank you so much. It's really a
blessing to be here.
You.
And sojo.net for us is not a restaurant.
Sojo.net.
Sojo.net is where a lot of young people find the resources to go forward now. It's the voices that we're trying to lift up all over the country. And sojo.net is a place to find us.
I'm going to throw out a little idea here. It just came to me. And Jim, if you would like to put together, say, a table of 12 of different people, I will host that at one of my restaurants.
Oh, we're in. Could
Michael.
It be 12 plus 2?
12 plus 2,
can
14,
Debbie and I
yes.
be the plus 2?
What a great idea. I
just
love
that.
That's a really
talking.
Great idea.
Okay, let's
can we do that?
Let's do it.
Let's do that.
Let's
oh, my
I mean, let's do it soon. That would really be amazing.
Yeah.
So, and I don't know, maybe we'll, I don't know, we'll decide if we bring a microphone or not.
It's
I feel
a great
like
idea.
That would be an amazing conversation.
Let's go. It starts with us, right?
It
yeah,
starts
I
with
love
us.
That.
Wow, that's great.
Boy, what a great conversation. Thank you both.
Debbie Shore, thanks as always. Thanks for listening to Add Passion and Stir. Our producer, Paul Woodall, Woody and District Productive, the best place to do podcasts. And to our team at Share Our Strength and Kelly Griffin, thanks for making this happen. We hope if you enjoy the podcast, you'll go to Add Passion and Stir, look at our previous episodes, rank them, rate them, subscribe, let your friends know about it. I'm Billy Shore. This is Add Passion and Stir. Add Passion and Stir is distributed by District Productive. Our executive producer is Peter Ogburn. Add Passion and Stir is the creation of Billy Shore, Debbie Shore, and Paul Woody Woodhull.